You've probably wondered if it's possible for innovation and application resilience to coexist. If you're part of a team that works in a silo and you want to fix that, then this video is for you. How do teams organize in order to ensure that there is both application resilience and innovation? And who in the team is responsible for application resilience and who is responsible for innovation? Before I dive in to answer the questions I've just talked about, let me do a quick catch up on what I mean by continuous or application resilience. Continuous resilience is when teams move away from focusing so much on being robust and they instead face up to the fact that applications will fail at some point. They then start to embrace failure with the intention to build capabilities that ensure resilience of their applications when they ultimately experience failure. Organizations that seek to digitally transform and become tomorrow's disruptors are not able to do this without undergoing cultural transformation. Silos in software development occur when various roles that contribute towards software development rarely talk to each other, and this ultimately results in the absence of teamwork. Silos within a software development lifecycle get in the way of communication and collaboration, and all of this slows down innovation and the delivery of business value to customers. It's also worth mentioning that silos can contribute and introduce conflicts with roles, and we end up with people saying, "This is not my job," and all of this get in the way of a quality product being delivered to the customer. As teams seek to move out of this siloed approach, communication between teams is important. Communication moves teams towards a shared responsibility model, taking away the "this is not my job" culture, and communication is very important for innovation. So how do teams make sure that they communicate during software development? Teams can explore tools that better support collaboration during software development. Think of tools like GitHub, which are very popular among developers, as they offer collaborative features that make life easier for developers. Software development projects can be better organized using tools like Trello or Asana, which lets teams organize projects into boards so that teams can have a view of what's on the to-do list, what's being worked on, and what's done in order to eliminate confusion with project status. Good quality code is only just one of the contributing factors in application resilience. Performance efficiency, security, and functional suitability go hand in hand with good quality code to contribute towards application resilience. So if you decide to tackle these contributing factors individually, it's easy to fall back into siloed functions where individual roles within teams are responsible for only some of these contributing factors. It's, however, more beneficial for everyone in the team and ultimately in the organization to make quality a shared responsibility. This approach reduces development costs, and ultimately the customer or the end user benefits from a better product. Outdated organizational structures, however, tend to place responsibility on a single employee, a single team, or a single role. Organizing team structures around products instead of around projects will accelerate innovation and increase the quality of work due to increased collaboration that is fostered by this team structure. So, shared responsibility, collaboration, it sounds like I've gone and talked about another conversation, a very popular term, DevOps. So in the book DevOps for Dummies, author Emily Freeman describes DevOps as a philosophy that is meant to build a culture of trust, collaboration, and continuous improvement. Emily further goes to give a guide on how to design your organization so that you support this collaboration and continuous improvement. Is the culture of your organization healthy in that the worst of tech culture is avoided, with diversity of thought being encouraged? Are your team members empowered to make decisions without always consulting management for every decision making? Staying with this topic of DevOps a little longer, it is worth talking about the fact that to build a common DevOps team or having DevOps focused members in the team introduces shared responsibility in the team. Over time, several essential practices have emerged when adopting DevOps, and these are practices like continuous integration, continuous delivery, infrastructure as code, and monitoring and logging. So now that we've talked about the culture, what technical considerations will support this shared responsibility in teams? First one is distributed architecture. In the book, Fundamentals of Software Architecture, the authors contrast two architecture styles, monolithic versus distributed. Monolithic is described as a single deployment unit of all your code, whereas distributed involves multiple deployments of single units that are connected via access protocols. An example of a distributed architecture is a microservices architecture, which is an architecture style that structures an application as a collection of loosely coupled services which implement business capabilities. It is a way of breaking up a monolithic software into various components that can function separately, that can have specific tasks, and they can talk to each other through APIs. Continuous integration and delivery. The AWS white paper on introducing DevOps highlights capabilities that help you accelerate your DevOps journey and services that can help remove all the work that is associated with DevOps adoption. It expands on these essential practices when you adopt DevOps, some of which I've already talked about briefly when I talked about continuous integration, which is a software development practice where developers regularly merge their code changes into a central repo, after which automated builds and tests are run. GitHub Actions is a continuous integration and continuous delivery platform that allows you to automate your build, your test, and a deployment pipeline. It lets you create workflows that build and test every pull request to your repository and when you deploy your merged pull requests. Infrastructure as code is a practice in which infrastructure is provisioned and managed using code and software development techniques. And here you can get version control and continuous integration. So consider tools like Terraform, which lets you automate the provision of your infrastructure, including your databases, your servers, and your firewall platforms across various cloud platforms. Monitoring and logging enables organizations to see how application and infrastructure performance impacts the experience of their products and users. OpenTelemetry is a collection of tools, APIs, and SDKs. Use this to instrument, generate, collect, and export telemetry data to help you analyze your software's performance and behavior. Communication and collaboration is a practice that is established to bring the teams closer and by building workflows and distributing the responsibilities for DevOps. And then we talk about security. This should be a cross-cutting concern. Your CI/CD pipelines and related services should be safeguarded and proper access control permissions should be set up. The Open Web Application Security Project, OWASP, is a nonprofit foundation that works to improve the security of software. Their programs include community-led open source software projects, and they have over 250 local chapters worldwide. The OWASP Foundation has a published list of top 10 security risks to avoid in order to change the software development culture towards more secure code. It seems then that the old saying remains true. You cannot keep on doing the same things and expecting different results. Teams will have to evolve into a shared responsibility model in order to be more innovative and work towards application resilience. If you enjoyed this video, please give it a like and consider subscribing to the channel. Thanks for watching. I'll see you next time.